Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I'm still in Las Vegas for another day, more than I thought it would be. Had some stuff going on there in California. I thought I was going to have to pack it in over here and head back, but thank the Lord everything kind of worked out that at the last minute that I was able to go ahead and stay here. But, you know, praise the Lord. I ask you guys to pray for the ministry. I haven't asked in a while. Because, you know, there's always, the enemy's always trying to do something to stumble you and disrupt you. And I already knew it was coming. You know, I went to do that deliverance here in Las Vegas. Of course, four or five things were all going in the wrong direction at the same time. And you know, even though the Lord warned me about it, which it's just common sense, too, you know, when you're talking spiritual warfare, that when you're dealing with something like that, the enemy always does that. But, and the Lord had even specifically warned me. And then everything went haywire that day. Lots of things, everything falling apart, all the plans for the ministry all at one day. But thank the Lord it all worked out. You know, but it just, it's not a matter of, I know the Lord will work it out, but it just wears you down when you have to deal with foolishness, brothers and sisters. And that's exactly what it is, foolishness that comes against you when you're trying to do something big for the Lord, especially you're talking about deliverance, specifically deliverance, besides everything you try to do for the Lord. Anyway, brothers and sisters, thank the Lord, you know, because of the power of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that the yoke will be broken by the anointing off of people's shoulders by the anointing. I believe that's Isaiah chapter 17. So when I went to go do the deliverance, I mean, the demon didn't even show up. Thank the Lord. This young brother, I won't say his name, you know, he was humble and he's very young. He's only 19 years old. And his father had just killed himself about 6 months ago. I prayed with him last time I was here. Or I thought I did. Now I remember I prayed with lots of people. And he was there and I didn't get a chance to pray with him. But I did speak to him and talk to him about the Lord and evangelize him. But anyway, I was able to pray with him. Confirmed that he is, you know, since he was had this possession, that he had become born again in the last several days before I got here with a sister in the Lord here in Las Vegas. And then I was able to confirm by the power of the Holy Spirit and the word of knowledge and word of wisdom that he is free of this demonic thing that is gone. And then he just needs to go and don't dabble with magic again, you know, dabbling with this new age third eye stuff. That's what this young guy was doing. I'm just telling you guys, I'm not saying his name. I'm just telling you this so people can hear it. Whenever you deal with Ouija board, you know, seances, trying to do this third eye stuff, this new age stuff, you are opening up yourself to be demon possessed. And it doesn't always happen. There's lots of people that's played the Ouija board and didn't get demon possessed. Millions of people, I guess. But every time you do it, you're playing with fire. You're inviting the devil in your house. You're inviting the rebuke of the Lord, really. As I've said, the ultimate thing is the demons get their power from God. They have authority from God to torment people who are in sin that they might repent. I mean, that's the whole point. God allows this to bring you to the breaking point that will either you will go off the deep end and go mad and lose everything and be destroyed, or you will repent. So that's what God is pushing us to that point. And ultimately, the tribulation period is just about just that. Those people who will be here who will not be raptured, they will be pushed to the breaking point all at the same time. Instead of just individuals, the whole world will be pushed to the breaking point to choose this day who they'll serve, the Lord or Satan, by taking the mark or bowing their self to the Lord Jesus Christ and ultimately getting their head chopped off, or dying in all the wars and famines, pestilences, earthquakes, tsunamis, all that stuff. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm trying to make a quick video here because, as you guys know, if you've been watching my videos, if I make a video about the ministry, only 200 or 300 people watch it. I mean, that's awesome. But then thousands of people love to watch a video about a word from the Lord and about the tribulation and about the rapture or something like that. And I know I mention it regularly, but it really makes me worry about the cold-heartedness of people and those who are loved to keep finding out about the rapture. If they're going to go in the rapture, they don't seem to be concerned about anybody but themselves. And, you know, as I've made the acronym many times in the past, it's joy. If you want to have joy, it's Jesus first, others second, yourself last. But most people, 90% of people spell joy backwards. That's why they don't have any joy. It's yourself first, others second, and Jesus last. And so if you get your life in order, you will have joy if you follow the acronym of joy. So your personal relationship with the Lord is first. And then the Lord wants you to be salt and light to others and bless other people. And then last but not least, of course, is yourself. And, you know, lots of people like myself or other people, they've sacrificed their lives to go serve the Lord, whether it be in the Philippines or be a pastor of a church in the U.S. or be a deacon, or they do short-term mission trips, or, you know, they tithe, they give to missionaries, they give to their church, they do feeding programs, whatever people do in the name of the Lord. And this is what God wants us to do. This is part of being a Christian. Part of being a Christian is to give. You know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. So God is a giver. And that's what the word agape, God so loved the world. Now the word love, agape, what we call God-type love, is a sacrificial giving love. And that's the love that the Lord wants us to have. Without agape, I am nothing. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, that's the same word there. Without the God type of love, I am nothing. There's love. I mean, there's also eros, you know, a sexual love. That's a form of love. Brotherly love, you know, filial love, familial love, you know, like you love your family, all these different kinds. But the God type of love, that's John 3:16 and 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the love chapter, is agape, which is sacrificial giving love. That's why in the King James, really, it has an excellent word. You know, people that don't like the King James, they'll say, well, you know, it's love there. Well, there's four or five different forms of love in Greek. And the word there is agape. So the King James uses an excellent word. It says charity. Without charity, I'm nothing. And that's really what it is. The verb form of God's love is charity. To give. I mean, you know, the fruit of love. So love in action is to give. Give of your time, your energy, yourself. You know, sacrifice your will so that the Lord's will be done. Just like Jesus did in the Garden of Gethsemane. He said, you know, not if it be that, if you know, if it's be possible, let this cup, you know, the passion of the Christ, the crucifixion and all that, pass from me. But nevertheless, not my will be done, but thy will be done. So the biggest thing is like being in the Garden of Good and Evil, midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, as they say. The majority of people who are Christians, which is really so sad, their biggest wrestling is with money. Money is their God. They don't have a problem, you know, getting loud and getting obnoxious about being a Christian in public, you know, and making a scene sometimes and getting, you know, getting in a fight with people and argument about John 3:16. But when it comes to money, that's where they say, you know, this cup's going to pass from me. I'm not going to sacrifice for the Lord. Even my time, my energy, my finances, I'm just going to talk a good game. It's all talk, but no action. And that's the real reason why I get upset when I get goofy, obnoxious comments on my videos. Is this, those are the same people. They're all talking, no action. They have no love. They're manifesting, you know, they're just debaters and railers. They're just like the Pharisees. It's all talk and outward appearance. But when it comes to action, you know, I'm nobody, you know, I'm a sinner too, brothers and sisters, just like you, we're all sinners. But can you imagine, I mean, it just boggles my mind that, you know, people who watch my videos, they should obviously know that I'm a missionary in the Philippines. You know, I gave up everything to go serve the Lord, nearly everything in my life. You know, the comforts of America and my house. I sold my house, gave away all my stuff. Put the rest of my stuff in storage at my parents, and it's basically gone bad from being in the basement, to serve the Lord. And then some moron who's sitting in their easy chair back in the States has never done a single thing for the Lord wants to tell me I'm going to hell because I believe in the pre-tribulation rapture. I mean, how deceived, how obnoxious, and how blind can you be? You know, as the Bible said, pride goes before a fall. And that's what worries me. You know, this fruit, you know, the outward appearance. Jesus said you can judge people by their fruits. So when I see the fruit of people, you know, they don't give. They don't even watch, as example, my videos, anybody's videos. They're not interested in, you know, feeding the poor. As James tells us, perfect religion is to keep yourself spotless from the world and to take care of widows and orphans. You know, that's perfect religion, according to the James, the half-brother of Jesus Christ. I mean, God calls us and blesses us to be a blessing. Now, it's not just talk, but action. You know, going and doing. And as I've mentioned in videos many times, there's not everyone's called to go to the Philippines. Not everybody's called to go be a missionary in Africa or whatever. There are people who are business people, and their job is to financially give and support missionaries, to give to buy Bibles, whatever the Lord would lead you to do. Very few people, brothers and sisters, give to the work of the Lord. And that is a huge idol in the American church or in the body of Christ. And that's why I'm making this video. If you guys know, we have an opportunity, as I've told you, we've increased the orphans. You know, we're going almost to 20 orphans, okay? And that's, we will have 20 orphans, should be by the end of the month of March. Now, every orphan is more money, and then we need to buy a vehicle. And right now, there's a unique offer we can get. The vehicle, we're trying to buy a truck to transport all the orphans. You're talking about 20 orphans to school and all that. We're just been piling them on the back of a motorcycle. I've made videos and showed the picture of like six kids and the house dad on a motorcycle, no helmets, riding. And no one had the heart to say, hey, you know, one of those kids could fall off the motorcycle and be killed. You know, I don't give one single penny to anything to do with the Lord. Hey, I might want to give, you know, the tithes I didn't give even for the last year or 5 years or 10 years or whatever. You know, I could give that to buy some helmets for those kids or buy a little truck or a car or some kind of a vehicle that these kids won't fall off and get killed. People just don't care. I mean, that's what I'm trying to say. And, you know, I've been just, not, you know, the Lord provides. And people say that. It's always really funny. Those same people that don't give, they always have glib little comments. Oh, we need to trust the Lord. Yeah, you know, Jesus said, give and it will be given unto you. In good measure, pressed down, running over, and shaken together, will men give into your bosom. For with the same measure you use, it'll be measured back to you. He who reaps or sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. The Lord is talking about money and other things too. It's true with all things of God. What we sow with is what we reap. As we judge, Jesus said, judge not, lest you be judged. Because the same measure you judge with, it'll be measured back to you. It's the same principle. God has the same principle. You need love, sow love. You need mercy, sow mercy. It's really true. It's not about the prosperity gospel. If you sow financially, you will reap financially. That's true. That's a biblical principle of all things. It's not about prosperity. It's that God blesses his people. Jesus tells us, the Bible tells us, to help the poor, feed the poor. That's literally. Literally feed them, not just spiritually, but literally. People love to justify themselves and make excuses for whatever is their idol, whether it be smoking cigarettes, drinking beer, you know, not giving any money to the work of the Lord. They always justify it. You could tap dance and come up with 100 different excuses. But right now, as an example, in this case, we have an opportunity to buy a vehicle. The vehicle we're going to buy, brothers and sisters, is made from spare salvaged parts from Japan. I mean, this is not even a new vehicle. If we were buying a new truck that we need, like a big 2-ton truck or whatever, it would be like $30,000 or $40,000, okay? But we can get, which probably not even safe, but you know, I have to go on the cheap because alleged Christians are so cheap. And you know, they're so tight with something they might do for the Lord, but for themselves, you know, they don't buy, you know, the generic brand, they get the branded one. But for the Lord, they want to give the generic brand. But anyway, there's salvage parts from Japan, from wrecked trucks and spare parts, that they send them to the Philippines, and then Filipinos, because they don't have any money, they assemble those old raggedy pieces together and weld it together, you know, a bunch of drunk morons, and who knows, you know, the steering wheel might fall off of it, but they will, which has happened, that's happened several times in the Philippines, one of these recycled, rebuilt, reclaimed, salvaged vehicles, that the steering wheel fell off while somebody was driving it. But anyway, we can get one for about $8,000. And in this case, somebody bought one and they're in a financial crisis and they want to sell it ASAP for $7,000. You know, we don't have the money to buy it. So, I mean, that's $1,000 we could save if we buy it now. Plus, we have the orphans and we need it now. Now, you know, I've made a video about it before. And, you know, I'm doing the YouTube ministry to to bless the people with a word from the Lord and about the end times and all that, and all that the Lord would allow me to do, you know, to get people saved. There's lots of people who got saved from the videos and all that stuff and discipled. But God has a heart for orphans, and God has a heart for the poor. And that's, you know, one of the big reasons why the Lord wants this YouTube channel to connect people who don't go to a regular church and they don't tithe, they don't give, and they want a place to give for the Lord's work to be done. And that's the connection that's made through this YouTube channel. Lord is using me to facilitate that. I've got a house mom and a house dad, and then by the grace of God, we have more orphanages with house moms and house dads. I'm overseeing the spiritual growth of the orphans and overseeing that everything's done right and facilitating connecting Americans or English-speaking people, Canadians and Europeans and all that too, Australians, New Zealanders, all those people and Europeans, connecting them to do this work for the Lord. It's not my work. You know, if the orphanage closed down tomorrow, if the Lord allowed it to close down, it'll close down. I mean, it's the Lord's business, not mine. You know, but the Lord has prompted me to be, you know, to be a spokesman for this thing, that the Lord wants it to continue. That would makes no difference. You know, it's no personal benefit or gain or loss for me if the orphanage is open or not. This is the Lord's work, the Lord's business, His alone. So I asked you, for those of you who are wrestling and you're in the Garden of Gethsemane, desiring to do your own will and sweating it about giving, what the Lord wants us to do is to give, and the tithe is under the law, but it is a measure. The tithe is a standard measure that gives us an idea of what we should give. As a matter of fact, just like Jesus did with everything in the law, He said, you've heard it's been said, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, if you look on a woman with lust, you've committed adultery in your heart. So the same thing with money. The New Testament says God loves a cheerful giver. A cheerful giver. And the law, you just gave. You could be grumbling and mumbling about it. Well, you got to give 10%. That's the law. But in the New Testament, God says He loves a cheerful giver. So God takes it to a higher level, not to a lower level, but to the thoughts and intents of your heart. Is money your God or not? Jesus said you can't serve two masters. You can't serve God and money. And that's where lots of people stumble. The biggest stumbling block, I think, in the church is money. Now, brothers and sisters, if you don't want to give to the Lord's work, and you know you don't give at your church, you don't want to give to Joshua's ministry, fine, that's between you and the Lord. You know, I don't want to hear anybody justifying themselves of why they don't give to the Lord's work. If you don't want to give, fine. You know, it's up between you and the Lord. I don't care. I just don't want to hear no cute, quaint, trite answers from those who are burying their treasure from the Lord and trying to be cutesy with me. Say, oh, just have more faith. No, you need to have more faith. I've got faith. You need to have faith that if you give, it'll be given unto you in good measure. I'm not calling the Lord a liar. Those who don't give are calling the Lord a liar. They don't trust the Lord with their money. It's their God, their idol. That's exactly what it is. That's exactly what it is. Even on this trip, brothers and sisters, you know, I haven't had the budget on this trip to do the things that the Lord wants me to do. I mean, I haven't really, you know, talked about it too much, but the Lord is, you know, it's in the Lord's time when the Lord pressed me to talk about it. You know, it's a budget constraint. I have to spend all the time. People want me to give them a word. I visit people, try to pray for them, minister to them, and then I have to deal with all this administrative thing. Do I have enough money to do it? And don't give me that trite stuff walking by faith, because I'll bet 99.99% of the people watching this video have never stepped out of the boat. They have no idea what they're talking about. You know, you cannot, you know, it's all cute in theory, but go do it. And I'm telling you, I bet there might even be not even one person watching this who's done that. Maybe one. One person. Say somebody else that's a missionary or a pastor that's walking by faith who's watching this, then maybe you. Maybe you. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I just got to put out there what the Lord has had me put out there. And ultimately, it's nothing personal. But God will hold me accountable if I don't say it. Hey, I got to say it. I mean, that's what it's all about. Speaking the truth by the Spirit of God, and then it's all up to the Lord to judge people, to deal with people, to work with people, whatever. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm not on here to be Joel Osteen. I mean, he's got the biggest church in the United States and a multi-million dollar budget because he keeps grinning at people and people hear what they want to hear. And that's not me. I'm not going to do that. I'm not on here to give you the breaking news and to keep grinning at people and making people feel good in their flesh. but to use the sword of the Spirit to go straight for the heart. And that's what preaching is, going for the people's fleshly, going after people's flesh with the sword of the Spirit to bring people into conformity to the image of Christ, not to tickle their ears and puff people up and make people increase in their vanity, but to bring people to humility and repentance. That's the gospel. God bless. If you know, there's, you know, there's when people watch a video, you got to, you know, you can turn it off or whatever. It's up to people, whatever they want to do. I mean, I'm just, it's nothing personal. It's up to the Lord, whatever He wants.